You may embellish yourself with an artificial smile that belies your feelings, and you may practice the art of handshaking so that you can imitate perfectly the handshake of the person who is apt at this art. But if these outward manifestations of an attractive personality lack that vital factor called earnestness of purpose, they will repel instead of attract. How then may one build character? The first step in character building is rigid self-discipline. In both the second and eighth lessons of this course, you will find the formula through which you may shape your character after any pattern that you choose, but I repeat it here as it is based upon a principle that will bear much repetition as follows. First, select those whose characters were made up of the qualities which you wish to build into your own character, and then proceed in the manner described in Lesson 2 to appropriate these qualities through the aid of auto-suggestion. Create in your imagination a council table and gather your characters around it each night, first having written out a clear, concise statement of the particular qualities that you wish to appropriate from each. Then proceed to affirm or suggest to yourself in outspoken, audible words that you are developing the desired qualities in yourself. As you do this, close your eyes and see in your imagination the figures seated around your imaginary table in the manner described in Lesson 2. Second, through the principles described in Lesson 8 on self-control, control your thoughts and keep your mind vitalized with thoughts of a positive nature. Let the dominating thought of your mind be a picture of the person that you intend to be, the person that you are deliberately building through this procedure. At least a dozen times a day, when you have a few minutes to yourself, shut your eyes and direct your thoughts to the figures which you have selected to sit at your imaginary council table, and feel, with a faith that knows no limitation, that you are actually growing to resemble in character those figures of your choice. Third, find at least one person each day, and more if possible, in whom you see some good quality that is worthy of praise, and praise it. Remember, however, that this praise must not be in the nature of cheap, insincere flattery. It must be genuine. Speak your words of praise with such earnestness that they will impress those to whom you speak. Then watch what happens. You will have rendered those whom you praise a decided benefit of great value to them. And you will have gone just one more step in the direction of developing the habit of looking for and finding the good qualities in others. I cannot overemphasize the far-reaching effects of this habit of praising, openly and enthusiastically, the good qualities in others. For this habit will soon reward you with a feeling of self-respect and manifestation of gratitude from others that will modify your entire personality. Here again, the law of attraction enters, and those whom you praise will see in you the qualities that you see in them. Your success in the application of this formula will be in exact proportion to your faith in its soundness. I do not merely believe that it is sound, I know that it is, and the reason I know is that I have used it successfully, and I have also taught others how to use it successfully. Therefore, I have a right to promise that you can use it with equal success. Furthermore, you can, with the aid of this formula, develop an attractive personality so speedily that you will surprise all who know you. The development of such a personality is entirely within your own control, a fact which gives you a tremendous advantage and at the same time places upon you the responsibility if you fail or neglect to exercise your privilege. I now wish to direct your attention to the reason for speaking aloud the affirmation that you are developing the desired qualities which you have selected as the materials out of which to develop an attractive personality. This procedure has two desirable effects, namely, first, it sets into motion the vibration through which the thought back of your words reaches and embeds itself in your subconscious mind, where it takes root and grows until it becomes a great moving force in your outward physical activities, leading in the direction of transformation of the thought into reality. Second, it develops in you the ability to speak with force and conviction, which will lead finally to great ability as a public speaker. No matter what your calling in life may be, you should be able to stand upon your feet and speak convincingly, as this is one of the most effective ways of developing an attractive personality. Put feeling and emotion into your words as you speak and develop a deep, rich tone of voice. If your voice is inclined to be high-pitched, tone it down until it is soft and pleasing. You can never express an attractive personality to best advantage through a harsh or shrill voice. You must cultivate your voice until it becomes rhythmical and pleasing to the ear. Remember that speech is the chief method of expressing your personality, and for this reason, it is to your advantage to cultivate a style that is both forceful and pleasing. I do not recall a single outstanding attractive personality that was not made up of, in part, of ability to speak with force and conviction. Study the prominent men and women of today, wherever you find them, and observe the significant fact that the more prominent they are, the more efficient they are in speaking forcefully. Study the outstanding figures of the past in politics and statesmanship, and observe that the most successful ones were those who were noted for their ability to speak with force and conviction. In the field of business, industry, and finance, it seems significant also that the most prominent leaders are men and women who are able public speakers. In fact, no one may hope to become a prominent leader in any noteworthy undertaking without developing the ability to speak with forcefulness that carries conviction. While the salesman may never deliver a public address, he will profit nevertheless if he develops the ability to do so, because this ability increases his power to talk convincingly in ordinary conversation. Let us now summarize the chief factors which enter into the development of an attractive personality as follows. First, form the habit of interesting yourself in other people and make it your business to find their good qualities and speak of them in terms of praise. Second, develop the ability to speak with force and conviction both in your ordinary conversational tones and before public gatherings where you must use more volume. Third, clothe yourself in a style that is becoming to your physical build and the work in which you are engaged. Fourth, develop a positive character through the aid of the formula outlined in this lesson. Fifth, learn how to shake hands so that you express warmth of feeling and enthusiasm through this form of greeting. Sixth, attract other people to you by first attracting yourself to them. Seventh, remember that your only limitation within reason is the one which you set up in your own mind. These 7 points cover the most important factors that enter into the development of an attractive personality, but it seems hardly necessary to suggest that such a personality will not develop of its own accord. It will develop if you submit yourself to the discipline herein described with a firm determination to transform yourself into the person that you would like to be. As I study this list of 7 important factors that enter into the development of an attractive personality, I feel moved to direct your attention to the 2nd and the 4th as being the most important. If you will cultivate those finer thoughts and feelings and actions out of which a positive character is built, and then learn to express yourself with force and conviction, you will have developed an attractive personality, for it will be seen that out of this attainment will come the other qualities here outlined. There is a great power of attraction back of the person who has a positive character, and this power expresses itself through unseen as well as visible sources. The moment you come within speaking distance of such a person, even though not a word is spoken, the influence of the unseen power within makes itself felt. Every shady transaction in which you engage, every negative thought that you think, and every destructive act in which you indulge destroys just so much of that subtle something within you that is known as character. There is full confession in the glances of our eyes, in our smiles, in salutations, in the grasp of the hands. His sin bedaubs him, mars all his good impression. Men know not why they do not trust him, but they do not trust him. His vice glasses his eye, demeans his cheek, pinches the nose, sets the mark of beast on the back of the head, and writes, "O fool, fool," on the forehead of a king. Emerson. I would direct your attention now to the first of the 7 factors that enter into the development of an attractive personality. You have observed that all through this lesson, I have gone into lengthy detail to show the material advantages of being agreeable to other people. However, the biggest advantage of all lies not in the possibility of monetary or material gain which this habit offers, but in the beautifying effect that it has upon the character of all who practice it. Acquire the habit of making yourself agreeable, and you profit both materially and mentally, for you will never be as happy in any other way as you will be when you know that you are making others happy. Remove the chips from your shoulders and quit challenging men to engage you in useless arguments. Remove the smoked glasses through which you see what you believe to be the blueness of life, and behold the shining sunlight of friendliness in its stead. Throw away your hammer and quit knocking, for surely you must know that the big prizes of life go to the builders and not the destroyers. The man who builds a house is an artist. The man who tears it down is a junk man. If you are a person with a grievance, the world will listen to your vitriolic ravings, providing it does not see you coming. But if you are a person with a message of friendliness and optimism, it will listen because it wishes to do so. No person with a grievance can be also a person with an attractive personality. The art of being agreeable, just that one simple trait, is the very foundation of all successful salesmanship. I drive my automobile 5 miles into the outskirts of the city to purchase gasoline, which I could procure within 2 blocks of my own garage, because the man who runs the filling station is an artist. He makes it his business to be agreeable. I go there not because he has cheaper gasoline, but because I enjoy the vitalizing effect of his attractive personality. I purchase my shoes at the Regal Shoe Store at 50th Street and Broadway in New York, not because I cannot find other good shoes at the same price, but for the reason that Mr. Cobb, the manager of that particular Regal store, has an attractive personality. While he is fitting me with shoes, he makes it his business to talk to me on subjects which he knows to be close to my heart. I do my banking at the Harriman National Bank at 44th Street and 5th Avenue, not because there are not scores of other good banks much nearer my place of business, but for the reason that the tellers and the cashiers and the lobby detective and Mr. Harriman and all of the others with whom I come in contact make it their business to be agreeable. My account is small, but they receive me as though it were large. I greatly admire John D. Rockefeller, Jr., not because he is the son of one of the world's richest men, but for the better reason that he, too, has acquired the art of being agreeable. In the little city of Lancaster, Pennsylvania, lives M.T. Garvin, a very successful merchant whom I would travel hundreds of miles to visit, not because he is a wealthy merchant, but for the reason that he makes it his business to be agreeable. However, I have no doubt that his material success is closely related to this noble art of affability which he has acquired. I have in my vest pocket a Parker fountain pen, and my wife and children have pens of the same brand, not because there are not other good fountain pens, but for the reason that I have been attracted to George S. Parker on account of his habit of being agreeable. My wife takes the Ladies' Home Journal, not because there are not other good magazines of a similar nature, but for the reason that we became attracted to the journal several years ago while Edward Bach was its editor, because he had acquired the art of being agreeable. O ye struggling pilgrims who are searching for the rainbow's end, ye drawers of water and hewers of wood, tarry for a moment by the wayside and learn a lesson from the successful men and women who have succeeded because they acquired the art of being agreeable. You can win for a time through ruthlessness and stealth. You can garner in more of this world's goods than you will need by sheer force and shrewd strategy without taking the time or going to the trouble of being agreeable. But sooner or later, you will come to that point in life at which you will feel the pangs of remorse and the emptiness of your well-filled purse. I never think of power and position and wealth that was attained by force without feeling very deeply the sentiment expressed by a man whose name I dare not mention as he stood at the tomb of Napoleon. Quote, "A little while ago, I stood by the grave of the old Napoleon, a magnificent tomb of gilt and gold, fit almost for a deity dead, and gazed upon the sarcophagus of rare and nameless marble where rest at last the ashes of that restless man. I leaned over the balustrade and thought about the career of the greatest soldier of the modern world. I saw him at Toulon. I saw him walking upon the banks of the Seine, contemplating suicide. I saw him putting down the mob in the streets of Paris. I saw him at the head of the army in Italy. I saw him crossing the bridge at Lodi with a tricolor in his hand. I saw him in Egypt in the shadows of the pyramids. I saw him conquer the Alps and mingle the eagles of France with the eagles of the Craigs. I saw him at Marengo, at Ulm, and at Austerlitz. I saw him in Russia when the infantry of the snow and the cavalry of the wild blast scattered his legions like winter's withered leaves. I saw him at Leipzig in defeat and disaster, driven by the million bayonets back upon Paris, clutched like a wild beast, banished to Elba. I saw him escape and retake an empire by the force of his genius. I saw him upon the frightful field of Waterloo, where chance and fate combined to wreck the fortunes of their former king. And I saw him at St. Helena, with his hands crossed behind him, gazing out upon the sad and solemn sea. I thought of the widows and orphans he had made, of the tears that had been shed for his glory, and of the only woman who ever loved him, pushed from his heart by the cold hand of ambition. And I said I would rather have been a French peasant and worn wooden shoes, I would rather have lived in a hut with a vine growing over the door and the grapes growing purple in the amorous kisses of the autumn sun. I would rather have been that poor peasant with my wife by my side, knitting as the day died out of the sky, with my children upon my knees and their arms about me. I would rather have been this man and gone down to the tonguelessness, silence of the dreamless dust than to have been that imperial personation of force and murder known as Napoleon the Great." Unquote. I leave with you, as a fitting climax for this lesson, the thought of this deathless dissertation on a man who lived by the sword of force and died an ignominious death, an outcast in the eyes of his fellow men, a sore to the memory of civilization, a failure because he did not acquire the art of being agreeable, because he could not or would not subordinate self for the good of his followers.